Good job.
So.
All right, very good. With that out of the way, let us begin.
To begin with, let's start with some introductions. Hi, my name is Caitlin. I'm an art historian and art restorer. I'm particularly interested in how we tell each other things without physically saying it, particularly things like visual and audio narrative shorthand. I find those things tend to be fascinating. I'm also very interested in applying fine art theory to things that are not traditionally considered fine art, because fuck the definition of fine art.
Yeah.
If you were in our panel earlier, that's what we talked about.
Yeah, this is officially the first time in the history of fine art that somebody saying fuck fine art has gotten applause.
No, it's not. It most definitely is not. And this man is my husband.
What up? I'm the husband. But anyway, so in case you guys actually care about my credentials, which, like, why would you? But I do have a PhD in music history. I do specialize in jazz from the 1930s to the 1950s. But my most recent set of research is really about, like, cinema music and game music and how the composition of game music interacts with the haptic communication in video games and all that good stuff, whatever. It sounds really boring on paper. It sounds even more boring in real life. Anyway, so let's begin. Why don't we? So let's start with a quote. I always like beginning my talks with a quote. And from today's Pearl of Wisdom comes from Mark Slobin from Global Soundtrack's World of Film Music. The job of a film composer is to create an integrated and logical society, music and all. And then the second quote for today is, yup, what he said, but with video games. That's me.
So,
right,
yeah,
now.
One of the things you'll notice about video games is that when they get discussed in a, you know, sort of highbrow academic way, which is not often, it's often through cinema theory, because that makes sense, because they use a lot of the same things as, you know, the sort of camera angles, camera discussion, music discussion, that sort of thing.
A lot of the non-verbal audiovisual narrative shorthand really gets transferred from video game, from movies into video games. The key difference between film and video games is that there's a component of interactivity and emergent gameplay. So because this is a medium in which it is impossible to account for every variable and possibility, we're going to be talking about some of the very select instances of where this is applicable. Certainly this is not applicable across the board, but this is supposed to give you kind of a good primer for where to start and how to look at video games on your own through the lens of audiovisual narrative
yes.
shorthand.
Like all good researchers, we ignore everything that does not support our research.
Everything supports our research.
All right.
Okay, so let's start with this kindergarten fucking bullshit of the 8 elements of music. So in my time off from my adult duties of painting myself blue, I teach music appreciation. Don't worry, I'm not about to give you a crash course. Just kidding, I totally am. So I just want to start with a very quick overview of the 8 elements of music, because these are actually going to, like, all kidding aside, these are actually going to come in kind of useful when we're actually discussing some of the more refined components of some of the music we're going to be looking at. And they are as follows. There's harmony, melody, rhythm. And then there's timbre, texture, form. Then there's also tonality and dynamics. So those are the 8. If you want to know what those are, I will happily leave that information up on the screen after the end of the conversation. I don't want to take up too much time of your time right now. But basically, melody is comprised of pitches that form recognizable tunes or motifs. It's the hummable part of music. Harmony is the walls that kind of ensconce that melody.
You've ever watched a TikTok duet where a bunch of people jump onto someone's video and you can't quite hear them individually, but together they sound amazing. That's the harmony.
Rhythm is the pulse behind music. Obviously it's more complicated than that. It consists of, like, long and short durations that are inextricably tied to the rhythmic and, or rather, I'm sorry, the melodic and harmonic properties of music. But basically rhythm is the pulse of the music. And then the 3 other features, of course, are texture, is how many different layers of music there are, how many different instruments are playing, how many distinct instruments are to be heard. Timbre is the tone quality and the color of the music.
Form so, like, is a kindergartner playing a violin is going to sound real different than a professional playing a violin.
Or how a violin is going to sound different from a trumpet.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then, of course, form is the overall structure. And form can ensconce, like, microstructures and macrostructures, so, like, overarching things and small things. It's sort of like, it's the difference between how do you build a house versus how do you make a window. And then finally, tonality is the overall general key, whether it's major or minor or something other, and dynamics is the overall volume. So that's all the primer you really need to know to get into this. So what is scoring? So scoring in a nutshell is basically the combination of simple ideas into complex communication packets. And these are things that you're intended to understand explicitly and implicitly. So scoring combines these packets into known components. So basically what that leads us to is understanding, achieving understanding through interpretation of familiar cues, such as, for instance, you know, hearing a major chord when you're happy or hearing a minor chord when you're sad. If a character in a cartoon is going up the stairs, you're going to have it going dun 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 dun, right? This is called Mickey Mousing. And then establishing a relationship between diegesis and non-diegesis. In video games and film, this is probably the most important thing.
Does anyone know what the term diegetic means? Yes, okay. You with the red hair.
It means when a song is playing within the universe of...
Yes. So, for example, if you have characters at a big fancy ball and fancy classical music is playing, they can hear it. If you have a big, like, tear-jerking moment where someone is dying and classical music is playing, they probably can't hear it. That's the difference between diegetic and non-diegetic. Diegetic means your characters can hear it, it's in the universe. Mm-hmm. Non-diegetic means they can't.
Right. Yeah, because we're not constantly surrounded by music all the time, even though it sometimes feels like it. certainly in elevators. It's right in elevators, so anyways, before. But the point is that diegesis and non-diegesis directly connect to the communication of ideas in music, whether they're implied or if they're explicit. And then finally, we have the reinforcing of verbal and visual narrative points through the abstract language of music, which is probably one of the most interesting things about the scoring process. Music by itself is a very abstract idea. It's just a bunch of pitches that are rhythmically arranged with a collection of harmonies thrown together that we're supposed to kind of interpret as something. We're interpreting them as cues. And the way we understand how these cues work is something that is both inherent to our collective unconscious and something that is very much a taught thing.
Yes, it's absolutely something that we made up, like money.
Right. So under that, we kind of have to like understand that this is exactly where scoring comes in. And so the function of musical scoring is basically as follows. It is to set the mood, enhance the aesthetic, heighten the emotion, propel the action, provide contextual cues, and contribute to structural unity. So I think that no scene really exemplifies this better than this bit from Jurassic Park, right?
So everyone knows this song. Everyone knows this scene.
This species
so
of
you can feel the tension rising
is,
in the
music. The
Cretaceous
period. I mean,
this
thing
is to see the big thing.
It's a dinosaur.
It is.
All right. So let me just break this down really, really quickly. So the idea behind the scene is that you're expected to kind of have the setup and the big reveal, right? So up until the moment of the reveal, we have absolutely no idea what we're looking at. And so the music is effectively assisting us in creating this tension. You might have noticed that what the scoring is doing, and by the way, the score is in this case written by John Williams, who's probably one of the greatest film score composers of all time. The music is gradually rising in a stepwise fashion. It's going up the scale, basically, and then gradually instruments are added to create more and more layers up until we have the big cut to the plesiosaur, or not plesiosaur.
The brontosaurus.
Brachiosaurus. And the music kind of changes motifs completely, and at which point we're expected to kind of have that same sense of awe and wonder that the characters on the screen are experiencing at the time. And the idea is for us to share that sense of wonder.
The music is literally telling us what to feel in that moment.
Right, right. And so this is literally what it's doing. It's setting the mood, it's enhancing the aesthetic, it's heightening the emotion, it's propelling the action. The only thing that it's really not doing is contributing to structural unity, but that's kind of a long-term thing. If you really want to see structural unity, you go look at Lord of the Rings or something. So let's go ahead and talk about how that is also done in video games. And I think no game does this better than the intro to Mass Effect 2. So let's go ahead and skip slightly ahead to the destruction of the Normandy.
Weapons offline! Somebody get that fire out!
Shepard!
Distress beacon is ready for launch.
Will the Alliance get here in time?
I'm going to fast forward just a bit so that we can see the actual gameplay part of this.
Mayday! 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 This is SSV Normandy! We've suffered heavy damage from an unknown enemy!
So you can hear this heavy, heavy drum beat.
Together!
Very indicative. Nearly every fight music that's ever existed.
Now notice, this is actually kind of a cool thing, right? As soon as you step out into the vacuum of space, all music cuts. So you have this immediate cut between like the red visuals of the interior of the Normandy, and you have this, as Caitlin pointed out, this like pounding drum beat, which we typically associate with danger and some sort of like anxiety. And then as soon as we cut to the outside of space, like boom, all music is immediately cut. So again, very similar ideas are communicated here, setting the mood, enhancing the aesthetic, heightening the emotion, propelling the action, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So let's now go ahead and switch over and talk about what this whole idea of othering is.
All right. So we've talked about it for a second, but I want to give you guys a little bit of discussion about narrative shorthand. So how many of you have read the book Understanding Comics? Yes. It's a little outdated, it's a little old now, but Understanding Comics basically breaks down how we use visuals to tell each other things so that we don't have to like write text, so you don't have to have a person standing there and saying it. Narrative shorthand is basically how you tell people things without explicitly telling them things. You've most likely heard of visual narrative shorthand. So it relies most heavily on the tropes and cultural zeitgeist that the audience is familiar with. Narrative shorthand in Japan is going to be very different from narrative shorthand here. There's certain tropes here that do not apply in other countries. So you really do have to know your audience to use this. So one of the things that we're going to talk about with narrative shorthand is, how do you know these are good guys? How do you know these are heroes?
You can see their face?
Yeah, exactly. We have been trained from birth to recognize certain visual cues as good and certain visual cues as bad. For example, how do you know that's a villain? Yeah, exactly. We've been raised from birth to understand that certain visual cues mean certain things. That is exactly the same with sound and audio. Certain songs mean certain things. Certain instruments mean certain things. And just because it's been built up through centuries of repetition and centuries of people building upon it and upon it and upon it, it's become part of our culture to understand that. Now, like, here's the thing. We all know music sets the tone of the scene. We all know that. Music tells us how we're supposed to feel about a scene. We rely on music in video games, in cinema, to tell us how we're supposed to feel. If we don't have it, we become incredibly uncomfortable. Which has been used to really good effect by, does anyone know what that is?
Buffy the Vampire Slayer.
That is the episode of Buffy the Vampire Slayer where, trigger warning, she finds her mom dead. And the entire episode has no music whatsoever. Absolutely none. There is only sound effect. And it is so unsettling. It's one of the things that people talk about all the time when they talk about Buffy the Vampire Slayer. Because we are so used to music telling us how we're supposed to feel when we're left with kind of our own emotions in a cinema or in a media experience, we have no idea what to do. Mm-hmm. It makes us really uncomfortable and it can be used to great effect. So just a primer on what shorthand is as we go into talking about
this. So at this point, you're probably wondering, like, so these fuckers are talking about movies and music, and the panel is called Othering and Video Game Music. Like, when are we gonna get to that? And I have some good news for you. This is gonna be now. So, but before we do that, let's go ahead and talk about this idea of othering, because this is actually one of the very central things. So this is a term that's used frequently in phenomenology, and particularly it was adopted by Edmund Husserl and further developed by Martin Heidegger and Maurice Merleau-Ponty. And basically the idea of othering is a phenomenological term that's used to describe the distinguishing character, distinguishing the constitutive other, that is like the person, place, object, or idea from the cumulative idea of the self. And so it's, we have a preconceived notion about ourselves that is different from something that is not like us, right? So it's kind of like why we tend to experience kinship with certain types of domesticated animals, like cats and dogs. And then we experience less kinship with certain undomesticated animals, like deer, for instance, right? And similar things can be applied to a variety of other things. Like, we need to have our similars, to have two eyes, a mouth, a nose, a face, preferably some kind of like bilateral symmetry, two arms and two legs, right? And the, like, spiders are a perfect example. Like, how many here like just fucking hate spiders?
Yeah.
Because they're weird, right? There's like eight eyes, there's like four sets of mouths, there's like 16 legs. I don't know, I've never really counted. I usually just bust out my flamethrower and just like, but the point is that there's a reason why their arachnophobia is one of the more common phobias around, is because spiders don't look like us. And this is both a conscious and a subconscious thing. And so on the conscious level, obviously, it's something that is guided by the notion of the who and the what, right? The idea of the who is you, me, everybody else. Like, how do we define the idea of the self? How do we define it within the context of the what, which is the environment, which is like where we are located, how we interact with the environment, and so on and so forth. And this idea ended up being used extensively in colonialism through gender identity and in the realm of academia and knowledge. So in colonialism, obviously, it's something that was extensively and widely utilized to separate the others from ourselves. Like, for instance, if you're going to a country that is predominantly not occupied or not populated by white people, you're obviously going to somehow position them as the other. They are somehow in, and this is not my thinking, but like this is a philosophy that's been applied for centuries. They are the other. They are different than us. They are barbaric. They are less than.
Literally every group is in it to every other group.
Right.
Yeah.
Which
it's
of course,
just how people work.
Right. And this is not something that's exclusive to white West European
cultures.
We're
just really good at it.
Yeah, we're just extremely good at it, right? I mean, similar ideas of othering are very closely integrated into Japanese and Chinese cultures. There's just a lot of things going on. Like, basically, anybody who doesn't look like you is immediately considered the other. So it's also frequently utilized in gender identity, right? I mean, like, I don't think we really need to go into that, but the idea of queerness is something that inherently is something that
how many of you who are queer have an friend group that's almost exclusively other queer people? Yeah, exactly. Exactly. How many of us have this, like, oh God, it's the straights jokes. Like, exactly.
Yeah. The straights are not okay.
Yeah. It's this sort of intensive, you're not like me.
Right.
That's exactly what othering is.
Precisely. And in academia, it's something that's fundamentally used to support that kind of thinking. So it's used as a tool for distinguishing in-groups from out-groups, right? In-groups are things that look like us. Out-groups are things that are different and foreign and alien. So in academia, it's characterized as the familiar versus the unfamiliar, the comforting versus the unsettling. So in other words, there's a set of contrasts that's frequently utilized as a set of metrics for othering. Okay, so how does that work in visual narrative shorthand? Okay, well, how many of you have played Super Mario World? Okay, perfection. The first enemies that Mario stomps are Goombas, right? They're like these mushrooms with eyes, right? And Why? Have you guys ever wondered why it's Goombas and not other, like, Italian plumber-looking types? Like, I mean, it seems like a really arbitrary thing. Like, hey, let's make this, like, red fucker stomp them, you know, mushroom stuff, and then turtles. Turtles suck, right? Fuck turtles. Why?
Fuck turtles, yeah. MAGFest 2020.
Yeah. Two. Right. So, I mean, that, like, have you ever wondered why it's that? It's because it's something that's very easily distinguishable. On a screen, in a visual medium, you need something that isn't like you so that you can distinguish your player avatar against the other so that you know, okay, cool. So if I press the button, this red fucker moves to the right, and then he can like press the, you can press the A button so he can jump and like he can stomp on this other red fucker that does not look like him, but yeah. Looks like a mushroom.
It basically eliminates the problem of whenever you play Smash and all of you play a slightly different color and none of you can tell who is the green Link and who is the black Link.
Right.
It's removing that problem. It's a, right. This is your guy. These are the other guys.
Going back to Mass Effect for just a hot second, I'm sure you guys have all noticed that Mass Effect has a fairly motley crew of different alien species on board the Normandy. And just out of curiosity, how many of you have romanced a human in that game? That's what I thought.
Oh, look.
That's what I thought. Your silence speaks volumes.
Suck.
I mean, exactly. They do. Also, Tali is best girl. I will die on this hill.
I'll die with you.
So, there is a way to subvert this trope, of course, and this is like where you play as the monster, and this is usually done in games that very specifically cast you as the bad guy, like for instance, Dead by Daylight or Carrion, Aliens versus Predator, you name it, it's probably going to be there. The idea is that, of course, you're still given some sort of human characteristics, and there's like usually an extensive period through which like they tutorialize you into the process. But basically, it's the same thing as what we've seen in the film. It's this idea of familiarity and representation of the player avatar and affinity by association. We like controlling Mario because he looks like us. We like stomping Goombas and Turtles because they do not, right? Yeah. So it's a very simple thing that's hardwired into our mentality. It's something that pervades pretty much the majority of video game design.
Yeah. So no matter how much the rest of the world, the rest of the game is different, we have something that looks like us that lets us be a part of that world.
Good. Okay, so now we're going to talk about some examples of this. And I think that what we're going to do is we're going to start with things that are a little bit more less esoteric. And then we're going to go into things that are probably a little bit further out there in terms of game design. Now, none of this is going to be completely ground shattering for any of you. You've probably played most of these games and you've probably asked the same exact questions. What we're going to do is we're going to take a critical lens to a lot of these things and we're going to look at them from that perspective. So first game that I would like to take a look at is Dragon Age Inquisition. One of the reasons that I want to take a look at it is because my wife had just recently sunk like 200 hours into it and I was there for all of it. Okay, so I got to experience this game 3 times.
He played 1 and 2 while I played 3 so that I could have a custom world state.
I am the best husband ever.
Yes, he is. Anyway,
anyway, let's roll footage. So this is the first time you visit a Val Royo in Dragon Age Inquisition.
Which is, in case you couldn't tell by the name, the fancy French place.
Use them. But why? This is nothing but a...
What choice do we have, Liliana? Right now, we can't approach anyone for help with the breach.
It's going to be like 50 seconds.
Use what influence we have to call the clerics together. Once they are ready, we will see this through. The city still mourns.
Just a guest seeker, but I think they all know who we are.
Your skills of observation never fail to impress me, Varric.
Okay, I'm gonna go ahead and play the music for you that's actually in the soundtrack. So this was from the Dragon Age Inquisition soundtrack.
Thank you.
let's talk about some of the things that are going on here. So, do you want to start off?
I think I noticed all of you, that switch in the music. How many of you noticed the complete tonal shift out of nowhere? If you were paying attention in the clip, it happened basically as soon as that woman saw you and ran away. So the beginning of the clip is exactly what you expect for walking into a fancy place. Mm-hmm. We see, hey, fancy French place, lots of gold. We expect fancy orchestral music. It's exactly what we've been programmed to expect. But out of nowhere, as soon as danger is introduced, the music completely shifts to reflect that. It shifts to a minor key and this highly syncopated rhythm, which are things we both highly associate with danger in our music.
Good, okay. Very good. So let's break down what's actually going on in terms of the music. So one of the things that you might have noticed is that there's a fairly significant amount of the familiar in this. This music has very intense Baroque trappings. So if you're familiar with Baroque music, that is music from like the 1600s to about 1750s, you're going to hear a lot of very identical things here. So like for starters, it has harpsichord and a string ensemble, which is something that we typically associate with the Baroque period, but also by association, we typically tend to transpose that onto high society music. Harpsichords and strings generally tend to crop up in shows about like historical shows, like for instance, Versailles on Netflix or the Borgias on Netflix. And most of these things are fairly synonymous with the idea of high society. And of course, this is what Bawayo is. Now, what gets really interesting is how the ternary form of this. So you start off with one thing, then you move on to another thing, and you come back to the original thing. The way that's handled is really, really interesting. So the original, the first section of this, is extremely stable. Like, there's a lot of rhythmic stability. There is, however, some harmonic instability because it kind of oscillates between a minor key and a major tonality. But when you get into the B section, what it does is it switches from this really stable harmonic structure to a rather unstable syncopated rhythmic progression. And so this kind of, by association, for us at the very least, creates this correlation between this music and The Rite of Spring by Stravinsky, which also was kind of harmonic, like rhythmically really unstable and created a lot of anxiety in its audiences. So it's kind of an interesting association between the one thing and the other, and we're kind of hardwired to experience that from that perspective.
So basically the music is telling you, hey, you think you know this place, you really fucking don't. Mm-hmm. You think you know what's going to happen. We're telling you think you know what's going to happen. You don't. You are actively in danger in this place. Have fun. It's still pretty.
Yeah. Yeah. So it basically creates this idea of like the Russian nesting doll, where you have like the thing within the thing. And so you have the outer shell of this really lovely like choral accompaniment. Whatever, I'm just hit my microphone. The point is that the outer shell is extremely nice, but underneath it, there's like that air of danger. Right. Yes. So, okay. So the next example we're going to have is from The Witcher 3, Wild Hunt. I know, I heard some woos.
Yes.
So, I also agree. Yennefer is best
into,
girl.
Yes, she is. Moving into a little further away from what we expect out of musical scoring.
Okay, I'm just going to start with this tune. I'm sure most of you know this one. They're all so cathartic.
Yes. So in case any of you didn't know, that's the combat music from The Witcher 3.
So how many of you are familiar with the title of the song? No? Okay, cool. So this is called Steel for Humans. And it's written by the Viking rock band Percival. Here's what's really interesting. So this song is not actually their original composition. They borrowed a Bulgarian wedding song called Lazurovanya. I'm probably pronouncing it incorrectly. I'm Russian, Bulgarian is not the same language. But basically, they borrowed the song and reorchestrated it in a way that suits the aesthetic of the game. And we're gonna talk about why that's important in just a second. Here's the original. This is the original Lazurovanya song. So,
I know it's significantly less like foot tapping and like bobbing along to that one than the last one, which is kind of intentional.
Let's talk about what Witcher 3 is about. So I think we can definitely agree that Geralt of Rivia is not the main character of the Witcher universe. Like, yes, the books are about him. The stories are about him, but he's really more of an audience insert. There's
he's
a much larger story going on.
Pest exterminator.
Pretty much. So he is the audience perspective character through whom we experience the larger conflict, in which he, generally speaking, has only a very small part to play. The larger concern of The Witcher is with the subversion of various Eastern European mythologies and folk tales towards a kind of a more moralistic approach. So, like, if you really look at it, the Bloody Baron is essentially Count Bluebeard, right? If you look at the three witches in the forest and their collection of orphans that they borrowed from the nearby village, that's Hansel and Gretel, right? So a lot of these stories are really just borrowed from East European folklore and folded into The Witcher, but with a filter.
Yes, so one of the things that this is important about is we've sanitized fairy tales out here in Western Europe and in sort of into America. We've sanitized fairy tales a lot. Fairy tales are dark. If you look up the original endings to some things, they are fucked up. They are dark. They're warnings. Fairy tales and sort of like these animal fables that we talk about, that we've seen, they're warnings. Red Riding Hood was originally a warning to debutantes to avoid men. It's not about a girl getting lost in the forest. It's about, hey, don't go near that creepy man. The whole point is that these are moralistic warning tales. They're telling you that you have to act a certain way to protect yourself from the world.
So,
in our media, particularly here in America, we've sanitized them because we couldn't sell them to adults, so let's make them cute and sell them to kids. Now that we've hit about, what, 2000, remember when this came out?
Oh, 2016.
Yeah. Well, we can't sell fairy tales to kids anymore because they've seen all of them.
Right.
But if we can take them back to being dark, we can sell them to adults again.
Now, the one clarification that I do want to make is, of course, Witcher 3 was made by a Polish studio.
Yes.
And so they do have a different perspective on these things. So we, once again, kind of have to look at it from the lens of not Western Anglo-American objectification of a lot of these ideas, but rather from a very Eastern European traditional standpoint, where a lot of these folktales are part and parcel of everyday occurrences. And in creating a world that essentially kind of subverts a lot of these expectations, the soundtrack which accompanies Witcher 3 typically also subverts a lot of these ideas. So as an Eastern European gamer, you might be able to hear something like Lazurovanya and something like this and be like, huh, this sounds really familiar, except I know where I heard this before. So, and the similar thing happens in the story arcs and the different treatments of those story arcs. Now, as far as the actual enhancement of the gameplay goes, like, obviously these things also factor into how we play The Witcher 3. But from a narrative standpoint, like, because we're definitely looking at this from the narrative standpoint of how do these soundtracks enhance the different games that we're looking at, this is clearly one such example. So, like, the music's processed nature kind of gives it a very different, more modernized twist.
Yes. There's also the thing is that, so this tradition of Eastern European music is not meant to be super rhythmic. It's not meant to be super entertaining. In the West, we're used to music is entertainment. Mm-hmm. In the East, music is storytelling. It's not meant to have this very, you know, steady flowing rhythm, because the rhythm is meant to follow the words. It's meant to follow what's being told. So instead of getting, so which is why this works so well for something like The Witcher, which is based on this Eastern European concept.
Exactly. So let's go ahead and press on.
So again, music is storytelling. Music telling you. Music is storytelling. Music telling you things that you don't actually need to be told.
All right. So I don't want to hold everyone up. So we're going to just kind of blaze through NieR Automata and Halo. So NieR Automata is probably one of my favorite treatments of how a soundtrack is integrated with a game. And that's only because the person who wrote it, Keiichi Okabe, is almost as much of a crazy human as Yoko Taro, who's the creator of Drakengard and NieR Automata. So how best to describe NieR Automata? It is equal parts role-playing game, action, character action game, shooter, but also like this incredibly deep treatise on the nature of humanity and how do we preserve our knowledge and continue perpetuating the species and what it actually means to be human. Anyway, it's a lot. But the point is that a lot of us communicated this through extremely beautiful visuals and music. So how is this communicated to us? So one of the things that we traditionally listen for in music is lyrics, right? Particularly if music has lyrics, lyrics have a very literal meaning to us. Like we listen to them, they communicate meaning through words. Well, what if the words that are being used are different and strange, right? So let's go ahead and take a look at Memories of Dust from NieR Automata. What language was that? I will pay you $50 right now if you can identify the exact language without looking at the board. Exactly. So here's the thing. It's a made-up language, right? So Keiichi Okabe actually, when he composed a lot of the soundtrack, actually ended up creating a fake language that's equal parts German, Latin, and several other languages. So the conceit is that you're listening to the lyrics, right? And you're trying to figure out what the meaning is. And you're just not getting it. So the focus of your attention as you're listening to this music is dispersed because you're trying to focus on the one thing that we are naturally trained to listen to, which is the lyrics, and then your neural synapses just basically end up being crossed, which in itself is kind of an interesting parallel to what exactly is going on in NieR Automata, because NieR Automata's conceit is that everything is kind of really chaotic. So you're very quickly transitioning between different game types. You're not really sure about what the storyline is until the very, very tail end. And even then you have to play through the game multiple times to get all of the endings and really understand what's going on. And a lot of the stuff is kind of baked into the crust of this particular pie. So what is really instructive, I think, for us is to look at this again through the lens of othering in the sense of how somebody from a Japanese culture would look upon the languages such as German and Latin and be like, okay, cool. These are extremely foreign and different languages to us, so we don't really have a clear connection to them. Meanwhile, somebody from an Anglo-European perspective or background might look at German and Latin and say like, oh, cool, like this is all completely old hat to me. So the double layering of othering in this case is this examination of othering through a non-Western lens. As we're looking at NieR Automata, obviously it plays with a lot of non-Western concepts, but it also does so with a lot of non-Western introduction, or rather non-Western perspective on the music in which it employs.
So this is where, with Dragon Age, we're talking about, you're using music to say that it's similar, but a little bit different. Your expectations are being set. With The Witcher, it's similar, but it's a little more different, and the music is teaching you how different it is. This is music teaching you how exactly different this world is from your own.
Right.
There are very few rules that are the same.
And if you know the story of NieR Automata, I'm sure you guys know that the story takes place thousands of years in the future after mankind has effectively died out. I'm not spoiling anything here. And basically the only humanoid things are these Yorha androids that are living on the base on the moon and are being sent down to Earth to basically complete these missions. And the whole conceit of the game is what does it mean to be human? At what point do you stop being human? And what defines your humanity? And the very remote alien characteristics of that story beat are framed through this extremely weird music that kind of upholds and supports a lot of the ideas that the game is trying to sell you.
Yep.
Okay, and then finally, of course, I don't think we can go by without talking about the grandpappy of them all, Halo Combat Evolved. So I think that more ink has been spilled about Halo and the production history of Halo than any other game that I've read about. And Halo is kind of an important milestone, right? Halo has been around for a good long time. It's currently in its sixth primary iteration, a seventh actually, right, if you count ODST. And there's been actually a fairly well-documented process of how the soundtracks and the production of this game have been written. And so Martin O'Donnell actually has expressed himself that when he was working on the soundtrack to Halo, he had some very specific ideas in mind. Let's go ahead and identify those. So this is the main theme from Halo. So, as we listen to this, okay, cool, fine, it's fine, I'm good. As we're listening to this, we're clearly being given some clues, right? It sounds like Gregorian chant. It has that very smushy introduction. So one of the things that Martin O'Donnell himself has said is that as he was writing this, he was interfacing with the production people at Bungie, and they were like, so it should have an air of ancient mystery, and this is the only direction that they gave him. And so he's like, aha, I know it, Gregorian chant, right? And so at this point, we're looking at othering through the lens of temporal displacement. So we're looking at something very old, and so clearly he went back to one of the oldest recorded musics in Western music history. So he's othering this music through not necessarily a lens of looking at it from a perspective like Westerner versus non-Westerner, but rather by looking at it from a different perspective from a cultural standpoint. So we're going further back in time than any of these soundtracks have gone. And so the opening theme essentially represents to us this Gregorian chant. It's this very abstract, very neutral, and very flexible theme. It's basically musical shorthand in pretty much everything that we've looked at for things that are old and inscrutable. Gregorian chant is by definition weird, partly because we still don't really know how to transcribe and interpret it according to the original intent of the Catholic Church. And so flavoring the music of Halo with Gregorian chant is essentially shorthand for that exact thing. Now, where it gets interesting is when we look at Silent Cartographer from Halo. So let's go ahead and take a look at that.
The Covenant believe that what they call the Silent Cartographer is somewhere under this island. The Cartographer is a map room that will lead us to Halo's control center. The island has multiple structures and installations. One of them contains the map room.
We're approaching the LZ. It's gonna be hot. Get sensor, come out quick. Touchdown! Hit it, Marine!
Go, go, go!
I don't know, there's just something so infinitely satisfying about that transition from the interior of the faux hammer right into the thing. But Sorry, I skipped ahead. But the point is that a lot of very similar ideas there. So the leitmotifs, the themes from the original, are still very much present in The Silent Cartographer. They just reframed for a different ear. At this point, we have this pounding drums, like much, very much like what we've pointed out in the other interpretations of music. It's much more chaotic, much more intimate, and much more personal. And it's also using an extensive use of syncopation to basically symbolize danger to us. So this idea of othering is something that can be done through a variety of different flavors. It's not necessarily something that's confined to one particular thing, like, for instance, using a particular narrative shorthand, but it can be done from a variety of different perspectives, like a very familiar perspective or a different perspective or a something that's extremely opposite to what we're used to. And then it can also go as far afield as Gregorian chant. So anything you want to say? All right, so let's go ahead and wrap it up because we are coming up on the end of this and I do want to leave some time for questions. So basically, to conclude, musical scoring contributes to a more profound understanding of the narrative scope of a game in a variety of ways. One of which, of course, is that, you know, the objective of musical score is to enrich and enhance the experience that we have with the game. So how do we do it? Well, we can create a score that fills in the gaps that the story itself is unable to fill. You were gonna say something? Okay, so not every gamer is going to read every single line of dialogue in a game. Not every gamer is gonna discover every secret. But this is where some of the non-specific things about game design really come in clutch. So like you will have game soundtracks basically kind of filling in a lot of these holes for you. So the notion of other can also be a powerful tool in a composer's toolbox because it's something that a composer can summon upon to kind of create this very specific idea of like why this music sounds like this and what is it communicating to us. So basically it's musical semaphoring. Like think about how signification works, about like why when you hear certain things it brings up a certain memories, or like why when you hear certain things you think danger or peace or something like that. And this is kind of like what the idea of representation in music and othering is really aiming to accomplish. So this is my bibliography, so this is what we used.
If you have, obviously this is, you know, sort of music appreciation 101 understanding of this, because we could talk about this for like 5 hours and still not get super deep into it. This is one of those subjects that has a lot of depth to it. So if you want to dig into this more, you are welcome to take a picture of this link and follow it. It's got some really, really great stuff in it. There is also, if, you know, 4 weeks from now, you're in the shower and you're like, oh, I should have asked them this random question. That's our socials. Email us.
Please shoot us an email.
Let us know.
A message or whatever.
I may not respond immediately, but I will eventually respond.
I will respond right away because I got nothing better going on.
Yes.
So at this time, I'm going to put down this microphone down there. So if you have any questions for us or any specific comments, please feel free to come up and voice them. And if you got to go, that's totally fine. We understand.
Yes. If you have questions, we like to leave a little bit of time at the end for questions just because people usually have them because we talk fast.
We say a lot of stuff. All right. Any questions? Come on up. Get them while it's good.
Hello.
Hello. First of all, I love your costumes. They're awesome.
Yeah.
I guess that makes sense. So in the description for the workshop, you mentioned control, which I'm guessing was cut probably for time. But
yes,
I was curious sort of what your perspective on the soundtrack and audio design for that, how it related. Yeah.
Oh, boy. So... Control is an interesting beast, right? Because it's specifically intended to create a feeling of unease, but at the same time, it's also intended to create that feeling of unease in very familiar quarters. So like the entirety of the Federal Bureau of Control is essentially a brutalist structure. And it has like very familiar parts. Like it has the annex, the mailroom, the common room, like whatever. And it's only when you get to like the things like the speculum or like the big reactor rooms that you really start feeling the scope and the immensity of it. But, so I think if my recollection serves, a lot of what control does is basically creating really weird connotations in music that you're already familiar with. So like, for instance, it'll take some fairly conventional gaming music or like fairly conventional music that you're already familiar with and just kind of like alter some things, like bend some of the pitches or play some of the stuff backwards. So it's really subtle stuff, but it really messes with your brain. And I would have to go back and revisit it one more time, but I'm pretty sure that's one of the things that it does that makes it so weird and so kind of like uncanny in its way. So yeah, I'll have to go back to that and check it out. But great question. Thank you so much.
Other questions?
Yeah, please just come on up, grab the microphone.
So with the thing about how the made-up words, the made-up language can help with the othering, what are your feelings on Splatoon music?
Oh, great question. I've never actually played Splatoon. I feel terrible. But I can answer that question in the context of Panzer Dragoon Orta, if that makes more sense.
I'm sorry, did you just have stroke?
No, Panzer Dragoon Orta.
Okay. I have no idea what that is.
How do you not know what... It's okay.
You married me.
It's okay, we'll talk later. We'll have to have this conversation. So, unfortunately, I can't really answer this question because I don't own a Switch. So I've never played Splatoon, but what specifically are you interested as far as made up words in music?
Like all the songs are basically made of like just made up words that sound like vaguely Japanese, I guess, so the vocalist could sing them.
So this is a
it's literally not a word.
Okay, so there's a lot of very similar things, like obviously in The Sims and in Katamari Damacy and a lot of similar games, and obviously Panzer Dragoon Orta. I honestly don't know if it's a trend or not, but my perspective is that it's something that's intended to sound familiar, but not at the same time. And so it's intended to put our mind at ease, but instead of having us focus on, particularly in something like Splatoon is my guess, which is a fairly fast-paced game that requires you to keep a lot of focus on what's going on the screen, instead of having you focus on the words in the music, it's forcing you to focus on something other than that. Now, that brings up the question, why even have lyrics in background music? But lyrics sound good, man. Like,
it's really, really, really easy to ignore just instrumental music. Yeah. We do it all the time, literally. You are walking through a mall, you will straight up ignore the instrumental music. There, it's to the point that you will not even remember that there was instrumental music playing unless it's a piece you recognize. So having lyrics, even if they don't make any sense, does at least put the music into the somewhat conscious part of your brain that there is in fact music playing. But it allows you, instead of getting your brain caught on the lyrics, because if you hear words that you recognize, you will pay attention to them. Even if they're not saying anything, you will pay attention to them, they will take your focus out. So having gibberish lyrics allows them to have something that you will hear, but not hear so consciously you're not paying attention to what you're supposed to be doing. Thank you, that was a really good question. Yes, you, then you. I saw you first. Sorry.
I had a question around, I'm gonna pronounce it incorrectly, Timber?
Timber?
Yeah, okay, sorry. So my question around that had to do a little bit with the lack of lyrics and the gibberish music, essentially. And I was wondering if that had a narrative reason in like NieR Automata. I know another, like it's more anime examples, but like with Yoko Kanno or Yuki Kajira, they're known literally for using gibberish in their music. And I was wondering, especially like with NieR specifically, I think of like how childlike the music sounds. And I'm wondering if like that is what you meant when you were explaining that section of music theory, like in terms of the intentionality behind it and the feelings that it evokes.
First, I think I need full disclosure. It's really, really difficult to talk about NieR Automata in a 5-minute chunk when the entire game really requires you to kind of spend hours and hours kind of discussing it. So I apologize if I made it seem like it was a lot simpler than it is, because it's not. Like, obviously, that soundtrack is very complex. And I think, like, the second part of your question, like, the track you're referring to is Emile's song, I'm guessing, right? Like,
yes.
Where it's a very specific intonation and, you know, Emil at this point is a robot, but he still retains like his very childlike characteristics from the original NieR game and so on and so forth. So I think I would hazard a guess, and I can't really speak to this 100% accurately because it's very difficult to make those connections between like Yoko Kanno and
Yuki Kajira.
Yeah. But I would hazard a guess that saying that using that kind of intonation and timbre is intended to create a jarring effect. Like, it is intended to kind of put you off your game. And it's intended to have that music stick out, particularly because, unless I'm mistaken, the Emil's song is playing particularly when you're in the robot village, mm-hmm. right? So you don't actually hear it outside of that. It's just like, it's a very laid back kind of casual thing where you're walking around and you're interacting with all these different robots in there. So it's intended to kind of put you off your game. And it's intended to create this kind of like very not serious feel to it, which is kind of what a lot of the stuff in Cowboy Bebop by Yoko Kanno does, like Wokina Koina is one perfect example where it's just a bunch of syllables strung together, and it's again intended to be very kind of like tongue-in-cheek, like, haha, are we being funny kind of situation. But that's my guess, is that it's intended to be a respite from all of the seriousness and like all of the really heady issues that the NieR Automata soundtrack deals with, and mm-hmm. what the game really deals with. Mm-hmm. So that's my guess. I'm sure somebody's going to have a different perspective on that, but that's where I would go with that.
I think that's very valid. Thank you.
Thank you.
Same question as the control guy, but for Horizon.
Oh, Horizon.
Horizon Zero Dawn. Oh, boy. I have not finished Horizon Zero Dawn yet, so I would be not a good authority on that subject. But, you know, I wish I remembered that soundtrack better, which is probably not a good sign.
It's very ambient.
It is very ambient. It is very ambient.
It has a real nice theme.
Yeah.
A lot of like tribal mixed with like tech.
Yeah.
So, I mean, that makes sense. Obviously, they're going to have tribal mixed with tech. That just fucking makes sense. That's the whole goddamn theme of the game. Like, I've played 5 minutes of the game, and I can tell you that's the goddamn theme of the game is tribal technology. What's interesting is, personally, is like the tribal music that they use, because we tend to have tribal is tribal, and it's not. Mm-hmm. Because tribal is anything from like the Gauls who were fucking up England in like the 1000s to like Native American tribes to like African tribes to like Northeast Asian tribes. Tribal music is very different across the world, but we have this one very narrow idea of what tribal is, and it's heavy drums and slightly weird music. Like, it's slightly weird. It sounds slightly weird to us, but not so weird that we're put off by it. If you want a really good example of like working with tribal tropes is Sideways. There's a really, really, really good music video about how they made the music of Pandora mm-hmm. for the movie Avatar.
Yeah, it's actually right there. It's the Wonder Brian and Avatar soundtrack. It's that link yeah. right there.
It does a really, really good job breaking down why we associate certain things with tribal and why we associate certain things with, like, not us. And so I think that's sort of where Horizon is pulling from, is this, they're kind of stuck to tropes. Because if they tried to use anything other than what we expected for tribal, people be like, what's this music? It's weird. And like, they don't pay attention to the game. So I think they did what they had to do, but at the same time, they kind of also had to revert to sort of like, let's just have background music.
Yep. Yep.
So yeah, I just thought of it. The civilized town is the one that has the really pretty theme. That's super memorable.
Yeah. Yeah.
So it's
yeah.
like the little tribes, the uncivilized people who work in the Sun Nation.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
That is a common trope in literally everything. Ah, yes, true. Person in the hoodie.
Ooh. After this question, we will have to break because I think
there's yeah. Ooh, can you think of any examples of othering being used in a utopian concept text, as in like oh. our world is dark, but like maybe there's a other world that's way better?
That's a good question.
Hmm.
I mean,
othering, like the other is the better than us.
Mass Effect, probably. That would be my only guess, is that there is
I mean, Mass Effect has a huge amount of music in it. In particular, if you listen to the soundtrack of Mass Effect 2, some of that stuff is really, really optimistic sounding, man. Like, right down to like the techno components. Like, I know I talked a lot about like the grim dark and whatever, but Mass Effect, like, for all of its like Lovecraftian story beats, is actually a surprisingly hopeful narrative, which is why the music kind of echoes that to some extent. So, yeah.
I keep seeing it more and more, like, as something that people are like seeking in their heart more and more these days.
For sure, for sure. Yeah. I would have to get back to you on that. So I think right off the top of my head, Mass Effect is the only game I can think of that has that kind of hopefulness by default integrated into the story. I mean, I could probably cite like the billion different Star Trek games, but like, man, all their soundtracks are shit. You know, and I think that they also kind of completely miss the central thesis of what Star Trek is really all about by gamifying it, so that's not really a valid answer. So Mass Effect would be my go-to, but I would probably have to look into that. So if you feel like you really need a better answer to that question, feel free to email me.
If you want an overly specific answer that talks to my favorite current game, look up the theme for the Fade in Dragon Age Inquisition, because it's very different than what you hear throughout the rest of the game, and it is very much, like, even though the area of the Fade that you're in is not fun, it's not nice, you don't want to be there, the music kind of doesn't fully reflect that. And sort of, yeah, and this is also the music that plays whenever Solas is talking about the Fade, and Solas obviously thinks the Fade is better than anything else in the entire goddamn world, for reasons. So that's a really, really specific example, but I think it might be along the track that you're looking for.
Not for lack of both of these games being BioWare games.
I mean, BioWare is so built on, they build everything around their characters, which is part of what makes it such a good narrative.
This is true. It's a very character-driven narrative.
Yes.
All right, very good. Guys, thank you so much.
Thank you so much. We really appreciate it. And,